الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وبعد. We all heard that the topic for this evening is the Quran argues with mankind. And the aim behind this lecture is to discuss those rational arguments mentioned in the Quran which point to the truths of our religion. We all recognize to one degree or the other that the Quran is a book which attempts to prove the truth of its message. It does this by many ways. It does this by providing the evidences, and also it does this by providing the arguments which show that what it preaches to is itself true. Now, many people are under the misconception that religion and reasoning must not be in agreement. I mean, many people, especially in the West, and also now in non-Muslim countries, they're under the impression that if reason, you have something, you go by reason, then therefore revelation must contradict it, or vice versa. And in reality, sound reasoning, and I emphasize the word here, sound reasoning, is always in agreement with correct transmission of revelation. And again, we have to emphasize the words here, correct transmission of revelation. For there can never be any disharmony between true reasoning, sound reasoning, and revelation, true revelation from Allah, is what I. If there is a contradiction between the two, it either means that the reasoning is not sound, or it means that the transmission of revelation is false in this context. And let us give an example to illustrate. For example, when we look at the faith of the Christians, one will find that many of their tenets, many of their beliefs contradict sound reasoning. Let's take, for example, the Trinity. Here the Christians argue that even though they say we believe in a single deity, a single Lord, but yet they will argue that his nature is one of a Trinity. So here there's a contradiction. I mean, the mind, reason itself, cannot bring together these two disharmonious facts. How can the nature of the Lord of all the worlds is at one time a single nature and at the same time a truing or a trinity? So therefore, since it contradicts reason, they're forced to explain it away by saying, well, it's a mystery. In other words, it's something which the mind cannot accept. Reason cannot accept it to be true. And yet, if you look at the text of the religion that they hold on to, of their religion, that they hold on to, whether the Old Testament or the New Testament, there is nothing in there that can be shown to show that indicates to the belief in the Trinity. And so therefore, they neither have a true transmission of religion, nor do they have sound reasoning to support the most common or the most fundamental of their beliefs. And that's why even amongst themselves, you find them different sects and groups. So much so that one Muslim scholar remarked to illustrate the differences that the Christians have amongst themselves just regarding the basic of their beliefs, wherein he said that if you were to gather 10 Christian priests in a room together, they would come out with 11 opinions. So this shows the confusion that they have, because their faith is neither based in sound reasoning, nor it's based in true revelation. Now, reasoning, though, in order for us to know that it's sound, it must be confirmed either by the census or by revelation. I mean, when you think something now, you have an idea in your mind, you have a thought, you have some sort of a notion, some sort of concept that you're thinking, how can you prove it to be true? Well, either you witness it by one of your senses, or revelation supports it. So since we're dealing with, in this topic, we're going to be dealing with matters of the unseen, primarily matters of the unseen, so the issue of the senses here is not necessarily applicable. Therefore, we need to show that the reasoning is sound because it is confirmed by revelation. And so therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in his book, has argued with humanity using arguments based in reason to show the truths to what it is mentioned in the Quran. So these are arguments which are, yes, arguments of reason, but they are also arguments which have been revealed, revelatory arguments. And let me give an example to illustrate. For example, now, if we were to imagine that you were to now come across a person who was not a Muslim, and you were to say, and the person was to ask you, why is it that you fast the month of Ramadan? You might reply to them that, well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded so in the Quran. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded so in the Quran. And this answer would be correct, because you're now explaining the basis for the command. But let us say you now turned the tables around and you went to a non-Muslim, and during the month of Ramadan, in a month or so, you come to them and you say to them, fast the month, you have to fast this month of Ramadan, you should not be eating or drinking today. And then the person answers to you, asks you why, and you say, well, because the Quran has commanded so. The person here would not necessarily accept this reasoning because he or she has not accepted initially the Quran to be the words of Allah. And so therefore, one would have to first establish to them, for them, that the Quran is the true words of Allah, and then based upon this, then you can say, well, this is the commandment of your Lord, and so that's why you should be fasting during this month. And in the times when religion is unfamiliar, when religion is strange, like it is these days, for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that Islam began as something strange and that it would return to become something strange once again, so blessed are the strangers, we stand in need of these arguments which show the truths of the religion to be true by reason. We are in great need of them in order to prove the veracity of our faith to ourselves and also to others. And before we get into these arguments, I'd like to comment momentarily about this hadith which I just cited. The hadith tells us that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, as his companion Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu reports, that Islam began at something strange. In other words, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam first came, when he was first sent to humanity, Islam was unknown on the face of the earth. The majority of humanity was in a state of unbelief. Indeed, in another hadith, the hadith of Iyad bin Himar al-Mujashi'i, which is reported in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informs us that at the time of his sending, Allah looked upon the inhabitants of earth, in other words, human beings, and he hated them all, Arabs and non-Arabs, with the exception of some remnants of the people of the book. Because at the time of the sending of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the true religion of Allah had been primarily effaced from the face of the earth. Only very few individuals, maybe a handful of people on the face of the earth, had some notion of the true religion of Allah azza wa jalla. Because as you know, the last prophet sent before the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was Isa ibn Maryam alayhi salam, Jesus the son of Mary. And between the sending of Jesus alayhi salam to the sending of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 600 years. And it is around the period of 300, after the sending of the Prophet Isa alayhi salam, where you have the first council, ordained by the Christian Church, which puts as its doctrine the notion of the Trinity. So by that time, about halfway, to between the time of Isa alayhi salam and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you find the formal change of the religion of Isa alayhi salam from a religion of Tawheed, the worship of one Lord, Allah alone, to a pagan religion having Trinity and so forth. So the point is, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam informs us that Islam began as a religion which is strange, and that it would return once again as a religion which would be strange. Meaning that even though at the end of the Prophet's life, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you find Arabia in its entirety entering into the fold of Islam, and then thereafter, after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's death, you find that the Muslims spreading throughout the world, yet that Islam, after this growth and after the spread, it would return back strange once again. In other words, it would become something unfamiliar. And this is what we find today. We find that even though you might go travel throughout the breadth of the Islamic world, that for many Muslims, even though the Muslims now number a billion in number, many Muslims do not even know the very basics of their religion, the very true fundamentals. And that's why it's not uncommon that if you travel through many Muslim lands, you will find them worshipping others with Allah. If you go to the major Muslim cities around the world, you will find their graves of people who they venerate, considering these people to be holy and so forth, and giving them that worship which only belongs to Allah, as we had discussed last night in the lecture as to the existence, the purpose of our existence. And so therefore the Prophet ﷺ is telling us that Islam would return strange once again. And so therefore we find in these beliefs, Islam is something strange, that most Muslims are unaware of the notion of Tawheed. We find also that Islam is strange in the sense of the practices, that most Muslims are not practicing their religion, and that those who really adhere to the tenets of the religion in terms of the practice, the acts of worship, the conduct, the behavior, the etiquette are very few. So Islam again has become something strange, so much so that if you find a Muslim who truly is upon the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, both inwardly and outwardly, this is something strange indeed. Something strange indeed. So the Prophet ﷺ tells us that Islam, as it began, it would return towards the end of time as something strange. Now, when the religion becomes unfamiliar, when it becomes something strange, it does not imply that one may forsake it. And refuge should be sought from Allah from such notions. Rather, the matter is, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِي غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَنْ يُقْبَلْ مِنْهُ وَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. That whoever seeks for a religion outside of that of Islam, it would not be accepted from him, and in the hereafter, he would be of the losers, meaning he would be condemned, or she would be condemned to the hellfire for eternity. So, you know, most people, like for instance, let's say there is a special type of clothing, you know, a special style, style of pants, or a style of haircut, or a style of car. You know, when it becomes no longer popular, people stop, you know, trying to purchase that style. You know, they will not comb their hair that way. They'll not wear those clothes. They'll not buy that car because it's no longer in fad, it's no longer popular. But the religion of Allah, when it becomes strange, it does not mean because now it's strange, because it's something now which people do not want to follow, that therefore we should not follow it. No, that's of course not. But rather, the matter still remains the same, that it's the truth, and that to seek any other religion is, or any other way of life, would lead a person to destruction. So, now likewise, indeed, the opposite is true, that when it's strange, the adherent to it, the one who truly adheres to this religion, even though he is in a state of alienation, the people look at him as something weird, something an oddity. He is alienated from those around him. This person is in actuality in a blessed state. For the hadith of Ibn Sa'ud that the Prophet ﷺ says after saying Islam began as something strange and it will return something strange, Then the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, "Tuba lil ghuraba." Blessedness is for the strangers, for those who are alienated. So therefore, even though in numerically there are very few, even though amongst the multitude they look like oddities, they look like something which is maybe taken as an object of mockery and fun, but in reality they are in the blessed state, as the Prophet ﷺ has said. And in the hereafter, they receive the highest degrees of paradise. And this is very important for Muslims who are living in non-Muslim lands, where Islam, you have a double strangeness. See, if you are a Muslim adhering to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, truly adhering to Islam in a Muslim land, you have a strangeness between you and your regular fellow Muslim, in the sense that you have adhering to the religion strongly and strictly, and the typical Muslim is lax or is not adhering to the Sunnah while you're adhering to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So there's one strangeness. But in the lands of the unbelievers, there is a double strangeness, a double alienation, in the sense that you're alienated from your fellow Muslims, but you're also alienated from the unbelievers. And so therefore, for Muslims who adhere to Islam in these lands of the infidels, the lands of these unbelievers, they will enjoy this good fortune, this happiness, this felicity, this blessedness to the degree of their adherence of Islam. If any evil or if any harm comes across them, it's due to their sins. Indeed, one may notice that when a Muslim is firm on his religion, the unbelievers typically treat him with a degree of respect and accord to him a degree of honor due to his holding onto his religion, and avoid giving him certain trials or putting him through different states of humiliation as the person who is negligent with his religion, who typically the unbelievers then will take and attest and humiliate in more than one way. And like such are Muslims. For in the world, evil must occur to people. In the sense that, I mean, there is no way, the life is such that Allah tests us with good and with evil. So evil must occur. But when an evil occurs to a Muslim, it's much less in degree and in magnitude and in effect than the evil that occurs to the unbelievers. And likewise, the evil that occurs to those who adhere to Islam truly is much less than the evil that occurs to those who do not adhere to Islam fully. And likewise, the blessings that reach the Muslims is greater than the blessings that reach the unbeliever. And likewise, the blessings which reach the Muslim who is adhering to his religion is much greater than the blessings which reach the Muslim who is not adhering to his religion. For the believers are tested by good and evil in order to purify their faith and expiate their sins. And the believer, when he is tested by good or evil, he is motivated to act for Allah. If the believer faces some sort of evil or is tested with some sort of harm, he is patient and he reckons that to Allah Azza wa Jalla. And likewise, if he is given some sort of blessing like wealth or health, he then expends that in seeking the pleasure of Allah. So he's always between being patient at adversity or being grateful at the blessings Allah gives him. And so therefore he tastes a certain, or she tastes a certain sweetness of faith, a certain pleasure, a certain calmness in the heart, a certain satisfaction which the Muslim who is not adherent to the religion, let alone the unbeliever, cannot taste or cannot even begin to fathom. And so therefore, when one is faced with this alienation, one should not lead him to flee the religion, but rather it should lead him to be much more firm upon the religion of Islam. Now that was an introduction to sort of shed some light on that very important hadith. But let's now return to the main topic at hand, which is these rational arguments in the Quran. As we said, that during times of when Islam is unfamiliar, when Islam is strange, it is required for us to know these arguments in order to support our own faith, and likewise in order to explain the truth of Islam to the unbelievers. Now, in the Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us any of these arguments of reason, Allah does not, the arguments of reason, if you look at them, the nature of them are such that it does not presuppose you know some sort of fact or you have to know some sort of method of argumentation in order to reach the truth. For those of you, since we're in a university environment, who have studied logic or studied philosophy at one time or the other, you know that in the arguments of the philosophers or the logicians, it is required for them, in order to prove something, like in mathematics, you know, that you have to go through a series of steps in order to prove something. There has to be a premise, and then based upon the premise you make certain conclusions, and then you have to test these hypotheses, and then you finally get to the result. Okay? There's a method of argumentation. The Quran doesn't use this type of argumentation method. But rather, the Quran provides arguments which are clear and recognized by all human beings to be true. Because they are something which are either readily observed, and so for they don't need a proof, or they are something which are ingrained in the nature of human beings, and so therefore nobody could deny it unless somebody is just denying it just for the sake of argumenting, just for the sake of out of pride and arrogance, who doesn't want to recognize the truth. This is the nature of the Quranic arguments. And let us give some examples. As we discussed last night, and as I'm sure every one of us has known and heard, the most important matter in our religion is Tawheed. And Tawheed, of course, is to worship Allah alone. And it is rooted in our belief that Allah is one, that there is one creator of the heavens and the earth who is perfect and possesses these beautiful names and exalted attributes. And it is our duty to worship this creator, our creator, through our love and our hope of his mercy and our fear of his wrath, by obeying him and then fulfilling these commandments in accordance with the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That's Tawheed in a nutshell. So how do we prove this rationally? What are the arguments to that? If I told you, like as I did last night, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us some evidences, well, we accept them because we believe in the Quran. But what about for the people who do not accept Tawheed initially? How can we prove to them Tawheed through arguments of reason? Well, let's take the first issue in Tawheed, proving that the existence of Allah Azza wa Jalla, proving that there is a creator to the universe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides an argument of reason in the Quran for this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the 52nd surah, Surah At-Tur, addresses humanity by saying, أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ أَمْ خَلَقُوا السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ بَلْ لَا يُقِنُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, or were they created from nothing, or are they the creators themselves, or did they create the heavens and the earth? Indeed, they have no certitude. What does this mean? Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is putting people in front of just one or two possibilities. If your existence is something which you cannot deny, you're here, so you know that you exist. Did it come from nothing? Did you just all of a sudden just appear out of thin air? No one would say that. Everyone would say that he has an origin. He came from somewhere. So, the question is, are you the person who brought your existence into being? If not, then did you bring the heavens and the earth into existence? If not, then, who did? This is an argument of reason. If you accept that you had to have some sort of origin to you, there had to be something that brought you into existence, and you yourself was not the one who brought you into existence, nor did you bring into existence that which you see around you, the heavens and the earth, then the question is, what brought you into existence? And this is an argument of reason which we accept. I mean, now, if you go to a person and you say, well, I was walking in the desert here in Australia, and out of nowhere, out of the sand, a house came up, fully built, you know, with running water and electricity and furniture and so forth, people would think that you're insane. Because people accept that, you know, that things do not just come without any cause bringing them into existence. There must be something. And that's why the Bedouin, as the Bedouin said, you know, when asked, you know, how does he know that Allah exists? He says that, well, that, you know, seeing the tracks, the footprint, right, tells me that some foot passed in the desert. And seeing the camel's dung, you know, tells me that a camel passed there first. In other words, these things just didn't appear out of nowhere in the desert, you know. A footprint means that somebody walked there. The dung of the camel meant that a camel passed there. So in the same thing, human beings, likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, brings this argument that a person, I mean, if he's left to contemplate this, you know, he cannot then argue that, well, he just came out of nothing. Of course not. Nobody, you know, who is sane would be able to argue that. And at the same time, a person did not create himself, nor did he create the environment around him, the heavens and the earth, the universe. So then the question is, who created him? How did he come into being? And so therefore, a person is forced to acknowledge that there must have been something that brought him into existence. And that's why one of the Prophet's companions, when he was a mushrik, still a pagan, and he heard the Prophet ﷺ recite these verses from Surah Al-Fur, as mentioned in the hadith in Sahih Bukhari, he felt that as if his heart was going to leap out of his chest because of the effect of the Prophet's recitation and the strength of these arguments. He couldn't but, you know, saying, submit and surrender to Islam. Now, likewise, we find sometimes certain individuals claim that they are God, that they are the creator of the heavens and the earth, that they are the Lord. The Quran also provides a rational argument in dealing with this. In the incident which we find between Ibrahim alayhi salam and the king, who they say was Nimrod, the king of Babylonia, okay, king of Babylon. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to us in Surah Al-Baqarah, أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِي حَاجَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ فِي رَبِّهِ أَنْ أَتَاهُ اللَّهُ الْمُلْكِ. Have you not reflected or thought about that person who disputed with Ibrahim concerning Ibrahim's Lord, meaning concerning Allah? And the reason why he disputed, Allah tells us, is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him sovereignty, gave him the ability to rule. So he was therefore deceived by the fact that he was a total ruler, a totalitarian, a tyrant on the lands. So Ibrahim, إِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ الَّذِي يُحْيِي وَيُمِيتُ. Ibrahim, in arguing to him, said, to show him who his Lord is that he worshipped, Ibrahim alayhi salam says, my Lord is the one who gives life and causes death. So the king, the tyrannical king, says, قَالَ أَنَا أُحْيِي وَأُمِيتُ. He says, I give life and death. And then according to the books of tafsir, he takes a man who is innocent and kills him, and takes a person who is condemned to death and lets him live. He said, okay, here, I'm causing to live and causing to die. So Ibrahim argues with him and says, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْتِي بِالشَّمْسِ مِنَ الْمَشْرِقِ فَأْتِي بِهَا مِنَ الْمَغْرِبِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings the sun, causes the sun to rise from the east, so you cause it to rise from the west. فَبُهِتَ الَّذِي كَفَرَ. So the unbeliever here, the king, was unable to respond to this. So here is an argument of reasoning. You know, the king, the tyrannical king, tries to argue when Ibrahim says, my Lord Allah, the one whom I worship, causes life and causes death. And he says, okay, I also bring to life and cause to death. Here I'm killing an innocent person, and here I'm giving life to, letting a person condemned to death to live. So then Ibrahim says, okay, my Lord Allah, he brings the sun from the east, you bring it from the west now. So here the unbeliever is unable to respond. This is another rational argument in the Quran proving the existence of Allah. Likewise, we find in the Quran rational arguments regarding those, for instance, who claim that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken a son among human beings.